Asian Development Bank greenlights a $1 billion loan for the establishment of a low-carbon public transport system in Davao City, Philippines. Pursuant to the country's efforts to promote climate action, the project will deploy about 1,100 electric bus fleets managed by the private sector. Ideally, the green bus system will reduce by 60% the annual greenhouse gas emissions of Davao City's public transport. Around 800,000 passengers are expected to benefit from the project. The loan will also finance 1,000 bus stops, 5 bus depots, 3 terminals, and a driver's training program.
A Japanese research firm lists the Philippine economy as one of the countries most at risk from the El Nino phenomenon. Nomura's report came weeks after a U.S.-based scientific and regulatory agency declared the onset of the weather phenomenon. Nomura says El Nino, which is seen to bring drought and below-average rainfall to the Philippines, may pose a threat to the country's agriculture output. This, in turn, may result in another rate hike from the central bank. But central bank deputy governor Francisco Dakila Jr. says they expect the impact of El Nino on the price of goods and services to be minimal.
Workers in the National Capital Region will be given a 40 peso wage increase. This translates to a 7% increase from the prevailing daily minimum wage rates in the region. That means those in the non-agriculture sector will see their salaries rise to 610 pesos from 570 pesos. For workers group Kilusang Mayo Uno, the wage increase is long overdue. The group urged the Marcos administration to also increase workers' wages in all regions across the country. The Trade Union Congress of the Philippines also expressed disappointment, saying the wage increase is insufficient.
Kami po ay gravely disappointed. Masyado pong maliit yung 40 pesos. When in fact, alam naman po natin na yung dating 570 po dahil po sa inflation since last year po, ay nawala pong halaga nun ay 88 pesos. Yung 40 pesos po na dagdag na binigay ng ating NCR wage boards ay wala pa po yun sa kalahati nung 88 pesos. Yung 610 pesos naman po ay malayo pa rin po doon sa ating sinasabi po nating DOST Pinggang Pinoy Family Food Requirement po na nasa around 900 pesos po. Kung kaya't kami po sa TUCP, patuloy pa rin po yung aming struggle for wage recovery at true family living wages sa Kongreso po. Sapagkat si Deputy Speaker Mendoza po ay siyang nag-file din po ng counterpart bill kay Senate President Subiri po yung across the board 150 pesos wage recovery increase.
Meanwhile, an employer's group worried about the impact of the 40 peso minimum wage hike on micro and small business owners.
Worried lang kami na sinasabi namin yung micro.
Ayun na nga
eh. Dapat ng gobyerno yan. Kung talaga kayo pa lang, marginal na yung operation nila, dalawa lang naman ang pwede nilang gawin eh. Magbabawas sila ng tao kung kaya magbawas.
Or
ipatong sa presyo yung
yes, ganun yun, babawiin.
Ano nila yung ano, yung sweldo ang tatanggapin, no?
Okay.
Kung minsan, hindi na kaya ng merkado.
Tama.
Wala ka choice, kung minsan, magsara.
The wage order is set to take effect on July 16 this year.
The Philippine Senate President denies claims of tampering the controversial measure to create the country's first sovereign wealth fund. Senator Juan Miguel Zubiri says the updated version of the Maharlika Investment Fund bill he signed while in the U.S. only meant to reflect what senators had earlier agreed upon when they passed the measure on third and final reading. Critics have assailed Zubiri's move and urged him to send the bill back to Congress to deliberate on the changes. The Senate leader admits it was an oversight on the part of the chamber's staff.
Unang-una, there's no such thing as tampering. There was never a plan to tamper. There was no sinister move to tamper the measure. There was no tampering that took place. We just want to put on record that we just reflected the true intention. Let me repeat. The true intention of the provisions as reflected on the transcript of records. After checking the draft, we saw that there was inconsistencies on Section 50 and 51, which I actually, to be honest about it, was an honest oversight by the staff. Okay? Honest oversight by the secretariat and the staff of Senator Villar.
The Philippine Supreme Court rejects a second motion for reconsideration by the Makati City local government to reconsider its decision on a territorial dispute with Taguig City. The High Court reiterated the finality of its decision to award the entirety of Fort Bonifacio to Taguig. The High Court asserts it will no longer entertain future pleadings on the case. In 2021, the Court's Third Division awarded to Taguig City 5 enlisted men's villages originally within Makati. It also gave Taguig control over the Fort Bonifacio Military Reservation. The current location of the Lifestyle and Financial District at Bonifacio Global City. Ferdinand Marcos Jr. today marks his first year as the 17th President of the Philippines. He says his administration has made significant strides for the economy, but he admits there's a lot more work to be done. Joyce Balanso with the full story.
On the eve of his first year in office, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. admits delivering on his campaign promises remains a work in progress.
It's not something that you say, tapos na, I finished it.
Political analyst and UP professor Dr. Aris Arugay, in an interview over Teleradyo, said he is giving the president an incomplete grade for his performance.
Bibigyan ko muna siya ng incomplete kasi hindi pa rin naman tapos. May mga functions na natugunan ng administrasyon, ngunit may mga functions na kailangan siguro siyang konting kalampagin kasi napapabayaan katulad dun sa ekonomiya. Yun yung mga dumikit sa kukote ng mga Pilipino eh. Yung mga, I mean, wow, 20 peso a kilo na, nice, na bigas, yeah. No? At yung poverty rate ibababa.
I agree with him. We are not yet done. There are many, many things that we still need to do. We have to undo 30, 35, almost 40 years of neglect when it comes to the agricultural sector.
Marcos, however, believes his administration has made significant strides in his first year, particularly in terms of steering the economy in a post-pandemic landscape.
Yes, we have done a lot of work. We are beginning to see the systemic changes that are going to be part of the new bureaucracy. But there's still a long way to go. We continue to work on the economy to make sure that our basics, our macroeconomic basics are in place. We're still fighting with inflation.
One potential driver of economic growth is the coconut industry. This is why Marcos ordered the Philippine Coconut Authority, or the PCA, to intensify its implementation of a development plan to fast-track the modernization of this sector. During the 50th founding anniversary of the PCA, Marcos admitted that there is not enough support to the industry amid its big potential to contribute to the country's economy while uplifting the lives of farmers.
We have used the coconut tree not only for food and nourishment, but for shelter, for clothing, and a source of livelihood for many generations. Thus, it is important that we continue to develop and improve these products so that we can find new uses and expand its distribution to new markets.
Joyce Balanso, ABS-CBN News.
The Marcos administration moving in the right direction so far in its first year. That's according to economist Calixto Chiquiangpo. He says one good thing the administration has achieved is opening up the economy. That includes joining the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, or RCEP, trade agreement, which Chiquiangpo says granted the country access to big markets like China. The bad thing, elevated inflation that has brought food prices higher.
Sasabi ko, tama yung direksyon ng administrasyon. Mm-hmm. Hindi lahat tama, but meron rin pagkukulang, lalo na sa agrikultura. Ang solusyon dyan is liberalizing. Alam mo, dahil mataas ang presyo ng ating asukal, garlic, isda, etc., may ibang agricultural commodities, dahil sa tinatawag nilang quantitative restrictions, nililimit nila yung importation . So ang yumayaman lang yung mga traders. Dapat na sistema na dapat talaga baguhin para magkaroon tayo ng relief tungkol sa presyo ng pagkain. Kuminsan medyo mabagal sila sa execution. Pero tama yung direksyon pag o-open natin to the economy, becoming more engaged in trade. Binuksan natin nga yung renewable energy. Palagay ko marami pang gagawin tungkol dyan para magkaroon ka ng more foreign investments, more jobs for Filipinos.
In other news, President Marcos Jr. denies having reached a deal for the Philippines to temporarily host Afghans who once worked for the U.S. He says the Philippine government is still exploring options on accommodating Afghans who are awaiting their U.S. visas. The chair of the Philippine Senate Foreign Relations Committee, Aimee Marcos, had previously raised security concerns over the U.S. request.
I was a little surprised when I saw some of the news reports. There is a deal between the U.S. There's no deal. We're still looking exactly at how to make it work if we can. It's entirely possible that we will not find a way to make it happen. But we have a long tradition in the Philippines of taking in refugees, although these are not refugees. They're an entirely different class of person. They are Afghan nationals who are being resettled by the United States in the United States and or other places. There are security issues, of course. We have to be conscious of that. But there are even more difficult legal and logistical issues.
Philippine Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri says welcoming the Afghan nationals into the country would be the right thing to do. Zubiri revealed he met with U.S. State Department officials who sought support for the request.
Hindi naman po sila lilipat dito sa ating bansa. Ang request lang po ay para halfway house na kung saan sila po gagastos ng lahat ng Estados Unidos. Gagawa po sila ng housing, gagawa po sila ng facilities na pag-alis po after 60 to 90 days, pag-alis po ng Afghan refugees o po ng Amerika, maiiwan po lahat sa Pilipinas.